Hello everyone, I'm Dimitris and today I'm going to talk to you about the top 10 practices I hate in C++. Before we begin, I would like to clarify the following things. Aside of perhaps the top 3, all the rest are in random order. So if you want to hear what I'm passionately opinionated about, just skip to the top 3. I do not claim these practices to be inherently bad. It depends a lot on the context. Even so, in some cases, I may be just expressing opinions that are more influenced by my personal preference rather than a best practice or a rule. However, if there is a relevant C++ core guideline, I will in fact mention it. I will assume there are no technical constraints keeping you from using C++ or newer. The code in the examples may be oversimplified, and the pointed out issues may not be exclusive to C++. That being said, I'm giving you a fair warning. You may be triggered. Now we got this out of the way, let's move on. Number 10. I really don't understand why people prefer using an incrementing index to iterate over a collection instead of a ranged for loop. That is, when and if there is a choice. I'm under the impression this mostly happens because they have been taught for loops that way in a programming 101 course long ago, and since then they have been instinctively using it. I find ranged for loops much safer and readable. Let me show you what I mean. The first two ways of iterating over V are just bad. I mean, look at them. You simply cannot tell what the loop iterates over just by looking at the condition inside the parentheses. On the other hand, when you iterate over V using the ranged for loop, it becomes immediately clear that you want to do an operation for every element X in V. The related C++ core guideline is ES71. You know, during a code review, if I see a ranged for loop not being used, I get very suspicious and start looking into alternatives. Number 9. Manual memory management. People just don't learn, do they? They keep using their new operators and their mallocs with total disregard of smart pointers and modern data structures. I don't know about you, but I become very alerted when I see these particular keywords in a modern C++ codebase. It is very rare I have personally come across an unavoidable usage of the so-called owning row pointers and memory allocation with malloc. In most cases, it involves the usage of a legacy or simply bad API. Finally, some relevant C++ core guidelines are R3 and R10. Number 8. Misused smart pointers. From my point of view, the C++ core guidelines are very clear on when one should use smart pointers. More importantly, they have very well-documented semantic implications in regards to lifetime and ownership, so I just don't understand why we keep seeing the things we see. Typical issues I notice are using a smart pointer when a raw, non-owning pointer or a reference would have been perfectly fine. Alternatively, another bad use is aimlessly creating cert pointers without no particular excuse. I think the mindset is something like, let's just use a smart pointer to be on the safe side. There are many rules from the C++ core guidelines that cover their usage, such as F7, R21, R30, and so on. Number 7. Cryptic abbreviations and acronyms that one has to guess, misunderstand, or awkwardly wait until a brave soul inquires about their meaning. This characteristic spans across many domains and programming languages. However, I have noticed it is especially common in some low-end embedded systems. Possibly a trait of C developers? Who knows? Overall, I sincerely think it's a very bad trait we should leave behind as soon as possible. There is no performance boost if you use a super short name for a variable. You know that, right? There is a very interesting read on this by Elon Musk. Google for acronyms seriously suck and take it into account when writing software. Oh, this is a nice one. Number 6. Avoiding to declare a variable as auto. To be honest, my personal preference is rather on the extreme side of this. I typically like to use auto as much as possible. Specifically, I like to use auto only when I need to implicitly convert the value on the right side. For example, when I want a number with a specific range or a sequence of characters to be a string. Look, you don't have to be as extreme as me. However, I believe you should at least try to avoid repeating type names. And I'm not talking about just within ranged for loops. I think that if you have good APIs with nice descriptive functions, as they should be, then by using auto, your code is just as understandable, safe, but also very easily maintainable across small API changes. Last but not least, a relevant C++ core guideline is ES11. Number 5. Using C-style strings and arrays. I honestly don't understand why I still see these things in modern C++ codebases. In regards to the C-style arrays, compared to modern standard library containers, such as the vector and the array, the difference in performance is usually insignificant, and their elements are also continuously stored in memory. I believe the same goes for strings. The most important advantage of the modern data structures, aside of the new features which can make your life really easy, is the readability and the safety they offer. In case you need to use a C-style array or a string because of a legacy or external API that uses those types, then my suggestion would be to use their modern equivalents and fall back to the legacy types only when you invoke the API that needs them. Some of the related C++ core guidelines are R14 and SLSTR1. Number 4. Old-style casting. Ideally, you'd want to avoid casts altogether, but there are indeed some cases where they are necessary. That being said, what you should definitely not do is C-style casts. Honestly, I like their looks, I'll give you that. But people sometimes tend to do nasty shortcuts using them, so yeah, let's just don't. If there is a need to cast, then use a named cast, in which case a static cast will be the thing you'd want in most scenario. Cast-related C++ core guidelines include ES48 and ES49. All right, now we are entering the top three things I hate the most. As I mentioned earlier, the previous points were in a pretty much random order, but the remaining ones, I do hate the most. Number 3, optimizing for performance. This could be broken down to multiple practices, but the reason behind them can be traced back to the very same cause. Someone using performance optimization as an excuse to write shitty, hard to test, and error-prone software. My opinion is that if you want to optimize something, the first question you need to ask yourself is if this makes sense from a business perspective. Does this bring value to your product or component? You can discover this by defining one or more quantifiable metrics that you want to improve. Then you need to prove the relation of this metric to the perceived value of your product offering. For example, you can set up an experiment with your users to verify if loading the screen 20 milliseconds faster does actually improve their experience. After you have formulated your optimization goal and mapped it to the business, you want to measure how does your system currently perform in regards to the particular metrics. You will end up with a difference, a delta. Is this delta considerable enough to warrant action on this? is a solution that increases the technical depth of your system acceptable due to the business gains? You know, it may be so, but before you make any decisions that are detrimental to the sustainability of your product, do ask yourselves all these questions. Think of this before adopting a singleton pattern, you know, not using modern C++, or utilizing your own implementation of a standard library feature just because you think it suits your needs better, and so on. Number two, and this is one of the things I love to hate the most, abstractions leaking details. When you come to think of it, it's an oxymoron, isn't it? An abstraction is meant, you know, abstract, generalize things, aka be implementation agnostic. Once your abstract class starts giving very clear hints on the underlying implementation, then you have essentially lost the benefits of using that abstraction. You code against the interface and not the implementation only in name and not in practice. You violate the list of substitution principle and hurt, among others, the reusability of your code. You claim to follow object-oriented programming best practices, but guess what? You actually don't. You're simply an imposter. Okay, I may be kidding a bit, but honestly, this is an indication of bad design, the consequences of which you should very soon, if not already, be facing. There are two ways of leaking details through abstractions. Number one, using implementation-specific types for the return value or the function arguments. For example, having a supposedly agnostic camera interface with a getFrame function that returns an OpenCV matrix does constrain you, well, in using OpenCV matrices for handling the frames. My suggestion would be to use something more generic, such as a vector of bytes or your own implementation agnostic structure to be able to switch among different implementations of computer vision libraries. Number two, exposing an underlying implementation by having the abstraction mirror its API. When creating an abstraction, the interface is supposed to reflect the business values the consumer should expect. The abstraction is generalized so that the different concrete classes that specialize it can be utilized seamlessly by the consumers. Therefore, by creating a very thin and supposedly abstract wrapper over an existing concrete implementation, does not allow you to reap the benefits of using an abstraction because, well, you simply aren't. Take a look at the hardware abstraction layer interface. Its name implies that it abstracts hardware so that higher level components don't care what kind of platform we are running on. However, if you pay close attention and you are familiar with the Arduino library, you will notice that the various function names imply that Arduino should be used underneath. As a result, if we wanted to migrate our higher level components to another platform, we would have to adapt the particular hardware drivers to conform to the Arduino API, its constraints, and its domain-specific assumptions. Considering that the Arduino library was first created to be used on 8-bit microcontrollers, having to use that the very same API on a 64-bit x86 machine could be severely constraining. Similarly, let's assume we want to do inter-process communication and want to create an implementation-agnostic interface that can work on different machines with different IPC mechanisms. If our abstraction simply mirrors a specific API, let's say that of DBus, then once we want to switch over to another IPC software, it would be difficult to adjust our supposedly platform-independent higher-level components that are consuming the DBus-inspired abstraction. Overall, if your goal is to create abstractions, well, then make them abstract. Let them be general. Don't reflect a particular implementation in the exposed types or functions. If you do that, you will be doing exactly what you tried to avoid, effectively coupling your high-level functionality to a concrete lower-level implementation. Number one, and my absolute worst, I mean, the worst nightmare when it comes to C++. Interface names with a prefix or a suffix indicating they are, well, an interface. I'm talking about this I before an abstract class name or an interface in the end. Seriously, unless you are developing code for an existing framework that is already using this very bad convention, then you should simply stay away from this. There is literally no good enough reason to put something in a class's name to indicate it is an abstract interface. I mean, why should anyone care? If you would like to consume a class, then you shouldn't care if you're using an abstraction. If you would like to find where this abstraction resides or which classes implement it, then all modern and not so modern IDEs have a pretty advanced search and intelligence functions. You know, you usually just control click on something. It saves you little to no time to have an I prefix or an interface suffix before and after it. I have yet to find a good argument on supporting this very bad practice. Like, literally nothing. Like, every book and article I have read on the topic says it should not be done. Yet in every project I have been in, people just do it. Overall, the consumer of an abstraction should not care that it uses an abstraction, and similarly, a class that is specializing an interface usually already knows its parent is an abstraction. However, the biggest problem isn't in the name itself. The biggest problem with prefixing is its consequences, and now we go back to number two, abstractions leaking details. This usually happens when someone first creates a class, let's say foo. Then, to conform to the supposed object-oriented design of the product, they create an iFoo interface. There, right there, we have two issues. The name of the interface dictates the implementation. iFoo indicates that the foo concrete class must be used. But what happens if we want to have variants, let's say a bar instead? We would either have to make the naming inconsistent and have a bar class specializing the iFoo interface, or not be awkward and do the correct thing and find out what is the business value we want to get from these two classes and reflect it in the interface name. So why not do the correct thing from the beginning? However, that is not the most important problem. The biggest concern is the specialization being created after the abstraction. Ideally, you should first identify what is the business value you want to get from a class. Reflect that in the abstract interface in an implementation agnostic manner, and then move on implementing the different specializations. If you do this the other way around, you run into the risk of the concrete class influencing the supposedly generic design of your interface. For example, if you have a camera module that happens to include a GPS sensor, you may create a camera class with a getFrame and getCoordinates functions. If you create an iCamera abstraction simply by mirroring the concrete class's API, you will have implicitly made the assumption that all camera modules must have a GPS sensor too. In other words, you get an application-specific detail being leaked into the domain logic. To summarize, these are my two problems with prefixes and suffixes indicating that the class is an interface. Number one, this extra notation is meaningless, redundant, and just verbose. Number two, it does result in abstractions leaking implementation designs and an overall bad software design. And you know what? I really hate both of these things. And that was it. These were my top 10 practices I hate in C++. What did you think of them? Do you agree with me or did you just start hating me? Whatever the case may be, I would love to discuss it with you, so please leave a comment below with your thoughts, and if you want to see more videos like this, please make sure to subscribe to my YouTube channel. Stay healthy, safe, and keep writing good C++. Thank you.